Check out this show and other great shows live on your iPhone, Android, or BlackBerry at www.mobileradio.me.
Hey, everybody. Welcome again to another great Legends Radio show. And we have just a night of total legends. We've got comedian Jake Johansson. We did have comic Drew Carey, and if he lands in his plane, this is the host of CBS's The Price is Right. We're going to maybe squeeze him in. Evan has got just one of the all-time music, total legends, Nona Hendrix and some other great guests. But this is our first guest is a person, well, it's the amazing Julie Newmar, a person who, I've watched her for a billion years. I'm looking at one of her affiliated sites, Julie Newmar, let's see. Well, we'll get into that. Julie Newmar writes, but she's asking for her first crush. And she was my first on-air crush of any kind back in whatever year it was, 1964, when CBS was the Saturday before her TV show My Living Doll debuted. They ran sort of a preview of all of the upcoming new shows like The Munsters and this show, My Living Doll. And most of you, I mean, I don't even have to say it. Everybody knows who Julie Newmar is. She was the very first Catwoman on the very first episode in 66 of Batman on ABC. She's done a million things, a gardener, fantastic dancer, a great mother. She has been everything, an athlete, an 11th generation American, a Mayflower descendant. I'm looking at her regular website, julienewmar.com. That's N-E-W-M-A-R. The one and only incredible, and she's being honored as a legendary lady of stage and screen by the California Women's Conference upcoming, which is huge. The one and only Julie Newmar. Ms. Newmar, welcome to the show, and I have no embarrassment in saying you're my first crush.
Oh, hello, Mike. Well, the first crush, that's a book. That's the second book that I'm writing, putting together, actually. The first one is called The Conscious Catwoman Explains Life on Earth. It's just a little tongue-in-cheek, but it's lots of fun, and it helps you get through life, as it were.
I really enjoyed it. I wholeheartedly recommend it to everybody, so you can go to julienewmar.com for it. And just besides everything else you've done, and you have done everything, stage and the big screen and the small screen, and you've done a lot of things to improve people's lives. You even invented some kind of, was it nude or
stockings?
Yes. Pantyhose for women. I forgot that you were, just looking at your IMDb, you were on The Twilight Zone in 1963 playing Miss Devlin, who I guess was the devil.
Right,
and that kind of reminded me about that. You've done a jillion things, but with this latest, I don't know how many incarnations of the Batman movie series that had come out. But, of course, you were there were newsreels and stuff in the 40s of Batman, sort of like how they had the 15-minute little segments of Superman. But they never had a Catwoman in there, to my knowledge. So you were the very first Catwoman, the most popular villain of the whole Batman TV show, which was that big Wednesday, Thursday phenomenon we all grew up with.
But, well, that makes sense because, you know, the female, not against the male, kind of sort of with the male, with Batman. But you're right, it wasn't a big character in the beginning, but it became the most popular, and then they wrote 6 shows for me. So it's gone on to be one of the most preferable parts that an actress can play. So I think it'll go on quite beyond me.
Well, it has, but all of the TV critics, Hollywood Reporter, Variety, all of the trades write that, you know, they've had different people for whatever, I don't know if it was contractual stuff or if you had another TV show planned, but Eartha Kitt first came in, and then to when you couldn't do carry on the role, and then in the movie, Lee Merriweather. And now, I mean, we've had a succession of people from Michelle Pfeiffer to Halle Berry to now Anne Hathaway, all of Hollywood's top leading ladies, but nobody can carry your Catwoman suit, which was recently donated to the Smithsonian.
I know. I don't think they've ever... Well, the new Anne Hathaway cat suit looks very much like like the one that I had, which was fit very well, as I remember. There was a zipper in the back, and it was easy to get in and out of, and it kind of was like, sort of like melted licorice, I'd say.
The funny thing about the role, well, the role that you played, however many episodes, if it was six on that ABC Batman show in the 60s, which was the number one show, it was a total phenomenon, and it was, I think, well, it really was. It sort of foretold all of the stuff that's come since. Like, I filmed an interview with you at a similar small-time Comic-Con-like event in Oakland maybe 12, 14 years ago, since I moved up here from L.A., but this whole Comic-Con phenomena in San Diego, which is starting this Thursday, you know, it's the biggest thing. All of that, this is all kind of stuff you, as the most popular Batman villain or villainess, sort of foretold in 66. You know, comic book stuff, it wasn't on the level that it has been, and that you guys and Adam West, et cetera, sort of broke groundwork on.
Well, it's changed a lot. It's gotten darker and bigger and noisier, and the Batman's costume seems to have enlarged in size, expanded, shall we say? I mean, the chest and the muscles and the whole look of it. It's not quite as much fun as it used to be, and I think essentially it is for kids who like to put on a, you know, put a towel or something around their shoulders and run around the house and just have a raucous good time. And I've just heard so many wonderful stories from their parents, even their grandparents. So it was a blessing in my life to have this role.
But not just Catwoman. You've done a zillion things. You were on The Monkees, for example, as April the Laundress. You did at least three parachute jumps on Wide World of Sports, again on ABC. You were on Columbo. I think, was it on Broadway you were Lola in Damn Yankees?
Exactly, yes. That's what I really feel I did best was musicals. So singing and dancing in the theaters is so much fun for an actor because you're there at the party, you know. It's such a wonderful, rewarding feeling to do theater in front of real people. Television is fun, too, but you don't get the reaction until a couple of months, even as it is years later.
Mm. And, you know, I was talking about you being such a groundbreaker in all of these areas of entertainment, but I forgot, I think you were perhaps one of the first supermodels, and you've always been tall. Are you legit about 6'2", or how tall were you, or are you?
Yeah, maybe in 4-inch heels I would be 6'2", but I stand up very straight, you see, being a ballet dancer, so, and I'm happy to be tall. It took a while. It took a couple of years to be happy with what you are in life, but yes, the answer is yes. I am 5'11".
Well, they make such a big deal, but again, I think you were the very first. And before I forget, you worked with everybody in entertainment. You did singing and dancing routines on the Jonathan Winters special, the Danny Kaye show, Mike Douglas show. I think you were probably on everything. Of course, you had a long episodic role or several as the motorcycle babe on Route 66. Which a lot of people are seeing and discovering now for the first time on some of these nostalgia channels like MeTV and Retro and TV Land, which is just very cool. And in fact, I think that was a big moment, getting back to the Batman stuff, was wasn't it you, Eartha Kitt, and Lee Merriweather on a TV Land awards show before we lost Eartha a couple of years ago?
Oh, yes, indeed, yes. The three of us were together there. But Eartha had a half hour. She only had one half hour as Catwoman on the series, which went from 66, 67. But I had 6 hours, and Lee Merriweather did the film version of Catwoman in the Batman movie. But you know, it'll go on and on. It's kind of like playing Carmen. It'll go on forever.
Well, you were the preeminent one. Let's bring up, speaking of Broadway and all things New York, Evan Ginsberg, who is in New York right now.
Hi, it's an honor to have you on the show.
Hello? Yes.
And I don't know what that was, but anyway, Ms. Newmar, it's an honor to have you on the show. And I just want to tell you that my father was a New York City taxi driver, and he told me that in the 1960s, the only two people that stopped traffic in New York City were Muhammad Ali and Julie Newmar. Have you ever heard that before?
No, I haven't heard it told that way before. I remember one guy, he kind of hit a telephone pole or something like that, but I was a bit embarrassed when people told me about it. No, I didn't see Muhammad Ali, but that wouldn't have been something. And by the way, how's your father?
Oh, he's long gone, but
his heart.
Oh, thank you. And I know you hear so much about Batman. I was wondering what you consider some other milestones in your career.
Well, definitely playing the devil in
Twilight Zone.
Right, and then there was Star Trek. That was one of the earlier shows. And, of course, I was a ballerina, and I got to dance with the great English ballerina Margot Fonteyn in New York at City Center.
Wow.
In Sleeping Beauty. So that's kind of a milestone for me. Mm-hmm. And I probably worked with all the great comic geniuses of the 60s and 70s and 80s. And I have to tell you, comics, they are the most dour crowd of people. I mean, they're just so serious. They're always thinking about what's going to be funny. But it was great fun for me to work with comedians because it's all about timing.
And you just
about setting up.
Oh, sure, yeah. Sure. And you just mentioned some of the greatest shows in television history, Star Trek, Twilight Zone. How does it feel for all intents and purposes to be immortalized? I mean, these shows are going to be watched forever.
Well, that's a good statement. It's good to be immortal. I think we should all think of ourselves that way. I think maybe our better behavior, our better everything would carry us through the days and years. Mm-hmm. Not bad to be immortal.
There you go.
I'm saying that a little tongue in cheek.
Okay. And TV has changed so dramatically since these shows that we're discussing. What's your take on TV today in comparison to these classic 60s shows?
Oh, I love TV. I say I don't watch it, but I do. I watch the news. I watch all the British dramas. I watch Al Jazeera, forget me. I watch CBS, ABC, NBC. I watch everything. I've just got to see what's happening. I want to know. I want to be up to the minute. And all around the world, I want to know how the world sees us in its different way. I really like it that way.
I would be nervous to hear what a lot of other countries say about the U.S. considering some of our aggressive policies. But that's a whole different show.
We'll just turn on the TV. You'll find out. Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, but. Ms. Newmar, what do you see in the future? I'm sure you're still out there active, and what do you see down the road for yourself?
What am I doing with myself now?
Down the road, you know, any upcoming projects?
Well, I got four books, but anything and everything on the computer. I mean, you can reach, you can talk to people, you can make things happen, you can do films, you can do, the audience for whatever you love to do in life is incredibly, right at your fingertips. it amazes me. It makes us all young. Makes me feel young that I have that kind of a an audience. You know,
that's great.
Just go on Facebook. Just experience it.
What's it like to have 10,000 friends, or whatever the case may be?
I think way more than
pretty amazing,
it's amusing. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, pretty amazing. Yes. I'll turn it back to Dr. Mike.
And another thing is, it's instant feedback. That's another great thing. See, it's like being on stage. As what I said, you're at the party. You know, you're right there where it's happening. It's a computer's fabulous.
Yeah, you can post something and 30 seconds later, someone's responding. It's amazing. It's absolutely.
Before you finish typing, they've given you a read on whatever it is you have to say.
Yeah, no doubt, no doubt. Yeah. Dr. Mike.
And everything globally, or everyone globally, is going to go nuts for the conscious Catwoman. A gorgeous photo of her. I mean, words don't do justice. I know that's just the superficial stuff. And there's tremendous talent and brains behind all that beauty. But beautiful cover. It's the classic shot of her. Explains life on Earth. And also, you know,
you can
fairly
get it on Amazon.
Oh, Amazon. Well, as well as Julie Newmar, rights.com, mm-hmm. julienewmar.com. Mm-hmm. But because so many of us, you know, we didn't have Betamax even back in 64 when My Living Doll was on. I forgot who, if it was Rhino or one of those outfits, just released the few surviving episodes of My Living Doll on DVD. Any thoughts on that? Because it was interesting hearing that a lot of us knew that Robert Cummings had this tremendous ego, and it was your show. It was supposed to be about you. You know, there was Elizabeth Montgomery as a witch and Barbara Eden as a genie, and you as, I think, TV's first female first robot. Well, other than Twilight Zone, but they were never any female robots there. But that must have been gratifying. Oh, go ahead.
You know what's fascinating about some of these older shows? Now, even those in black and white. And black and white is wonderful. It makes people look so good, even better than this high definition. Sometimes it just overdoes it, you know. But the writing was wonderful back then. I think they told great stories. And The Living Doll, My Living Doll, the series that I did for CBS in 64, it then morphed into I Dream of Jeannie, and then there were the other shows that followed, and Elizabeth Montgomery. And in other words, the woman who would do right by the man or do anything for the man or be his dream woman. So it was a wonderful time, and it's worth looking at again and seeing.
It was a lot of fantasy. I just thought that show was great. I was sorry it didn't go on longer, but it must be gratifying now. People are clamoring for My Living Doll, the few episodes. I think there's like 6 or 8 on DVD. And did you have any input on that DVD project?
On the new project, they interviewed me as what happened in the past. So there's all the history there and the telling of what went on backstage and what it was like to make this show. It's quite fascinating. It's well worth looking at.
And amongst your many talents, besides everything else you do, is you're quite the gardener, and there are several species of flowers, like some roses named after you. Tell us a little about that.
Right. There's a Julie Newmar rose. And there's a daylily named after me, and now a begonia. And it's just that I love gardens so much. And I'm going to put out a film, as a matter of fact, on what it's like to look out this window that I'm looking out here and really show people that it's possible to create your own paradise, to live in paradise. And all you do, you just work on just a little bit at a time, and that after a few months or a few years, you just add a little, just that change a little bit here and there, and it is glorious. I think gardens are a place to either heal yourself or come together as yourself, or just kind of live a more a happier life, a blissful life.
Well, that's fantastic. That impressed me, since I also garden with my wife. And, of course, amongst all the other stuff, I think there was an E, was it E or A&E? I think it was A&E, did an hour or 2 hour special on your life, which was phenomenal. And before we let you go, and unfortunately time is wrapping up, so I'll have to have you back, definitely. But I don't think there, you know, besides being the very first Catwoman on the very first Batman TV show, that movie, I think you're the only actress or actor who've had a movie named after them, that Patrick Swayze movie with the three comics in drag.
Yes, To Wong Fu, Thanks for Everything, Julie Newmar. It was a send-up, just lots of fun, just a wonderful film to look for on the internet or to find. Very amusing film. And Patrick Swayze was brilliant in it, as was John Leguizamo, and wonderful film.
Yeah, we're big John Leguizamo fans here. Was that the movie that I thought Bette Midler was thinking of developing into a musical on Broadway, if I'm not mistaken, and maybe I am.
Probably.
I mean, that just is so impressive. So, you know, we were asking, you've done so much up to date, but are there any goals before I let you go, other than, say, gardening or healthcare stuff that you help people with? Any goals that you have upcoming, other than all your zillion projects? And, well, tell us actually where you're being honored. When is this huge honor for you? It's upcoming.
This is the California Women's Conference. It's in Long Beach, coming up in September, the weekend of September 23rd and 4th. And it's all the great things that women do and how they help each other, what they can do, how to start businesses, create new livelihoods, divorce breaks up a family. It's the flowering of womanhood, I think, because we go through so many reincarnations, actually, that this is a wonderful place to gather, meet each other, get new ideas, spawn or share your own ideas, and share with each other, and just grow up, grow tall, grow rich, grow in a wonderful way. So come to the California Women's Conference. We'd love to see you. It's a big auditorium, I believe.
I'll try to nag you a little closer to September and maybe come back on the show. It's been an honor having you on. I can't tell you what this means to all of our listeners and Evan and myself. And you're just globally loved. The young, still always beautiful, always contributing to the planet, Julie Newmar. With that, we've got to take a little time out for business here, and we're going to be right back with Legends Radio. Don't go anywhere.
Evan Ginsberg back with Legends Radio, and we just want to remind everybody that Legends Radio is heard generally Wednesday nights, 7 to 9:20 p.m. Eastern Standard. This is a rare summer night when we deviate from our usual schedule, and the opinions, the comments of anyone else in the show, not necessarily shared or endorsed by yours truly. And we have tons of great merchandise in our store, which you could check out at legendsradio.net, including my book, Apartment 4B, Like in Brooklyn. And as you know, folks, we were just listening to the music of the great Nona Hendrix, and she'll be on with us in just a few. And with all of that out of the way, we just want to say, Dr. Mike, what's happening in your world?
Well, I know I was saying this earlier. I want to dedicate this show to the great Ernest Borgnine as well as Andy Griffith. We lost two total giants. One thing about Ernest Borgnine, and I hope I can say this. This is just coming from me. It's not from anybody else. But he was interviewed on, I don't know, it was MTV or some happening show just a couple of years ago. And mind you, at 95, he still had all his marbles. But they asked him what keeps him going or how he stays so spry. He actually said right on TV, I masturbate a lot. It was just off the cuff. You know, a guy was still doing SpongeBob. He was making all these appearances in movies and TV live action and was as sharp as a tack. Saw an amazing unsung on Bobby Womack. And maybe on a later show, Evan can go into what a total legend this guy was out of the many. Ev, this show, Unsung, this was the one you were telling me about like a year or two ago on Trio, not to miss. And now finally I can see it on whatever cable channel it's on.
Yeah, we get it here in New York on TV One. And Unsung is tremendous. Basically, it's one-hour documentaries on legendary R&B acts. And most of them have not fared too well, whether it's the group breaking up or health issues or getting screwed by the record company, et cetera, so on. And some of them are really devastating. What comes to mind immediately is Donny Hathaway, who allegedly committed suicide at age 28. You know, just it really, really leaves you thinking about fame and, you know, some of the pitfalls that come with it. And great, great show, and really documentary filmmaking at its finest because it shows both sides of the story. For example, an artist will say, my record company ripped me off, and then they'll actually go to the record company exec and they'll say, well, said artist was very irresponsible with their money, blah, blah, blah. So you're hearing two sides, it's which is what a good documentary really should do. And rather than just paint the rosy picture, you know, there's always hero worship when you love a particular artist. But, you know, brilliant people have their demons. And Unsung, I just can't recommend it more highly. Just tremendous.
Well, they had Angela Bofill, who we had on this show a couple of months ago.
Yeah, very, very painful to watch. She had two strokes, and she's still having difficulty walking, and, you know, just very, very painful. And also they dealt with some of the pitfalls in the music industry that Angela faced, and just a great show. If you could get your hands on it, I'm not sure if the website itself shows the episodes in its entirety, but it's very possible. But check out Unsung, folks.
On TV One. Also, congrats to, and Rick was telling us it was a great pay-per-view, TNA's latest effort. Sima Ion becomes the ex-champ. Our own Austin Aries, who we all love. We've had him on the show. Evan and I think the world of him. He's their champion, which is great. CM Punk emailed both those guys and Samoa Joe. Congrats on a great pay-per-view. And then, of course, Anderson Silva and Opie Taylor. Anderson Silva defeated Chael Sonnen, and Opie Taylor, I guess that's what I call Forrest Griffin, defeated Tito Ortiz. And our own friend Kung Lee won in his, you know, crossover from Strikeforce, his UFC debut. So congrats to Kung Lee, who's a real good friend, good guy down in San Jose, movie star and all that. I know he doesn't have much more on his MMA plate. But Ev, we're all ecstatic about Austin Aries is a TNA champ.
That's right. Austin Aries is a wrestler. He's not a sports entertainer. He's a wrestler. And he's not a kid anymore. He's in his late 30s, I believe. And it's great, great that he's finally gotten his due. And I'm going to put my money where my mouth is. And when TNA comes to New York in 2 weeks, I'm going to go buy a ticket and hopefully see Austin Aries in the main event. But we're going to go from pro wrestling to great, great music in just a minute with Nona Hendrix. We'll be right back, folks.
They were sleeping on the floor. Mama's crying cause love don't get here no more. God is creeping around the door, saying you still haven't found everything you're looking for. Somebody's saying about love and peace. Nothing will grow unless we sow the seeds. We can be all that we dream to be. Do you pray to what you don't believe in anymore? North or south, west and east, it's sex and drugs, war and crime, signs of the beast. If it's too good to be true, but you know that it's something you have got to do. Take me down to the hole and see. Watch my brains break these chains. Say
All right, Evan Ginsberg back with Legends Radio, and you heard a complete set of her great music earlier in the show. She's a true legend. She's been with LaBelle. She's had great, great accomplishments on her own as well. She is the one and only Nona Hendrix. How are you tonight, ma'am?
I'm good. How are you?
Oh, great, great. And,
great. Thank you for having me on.
We're honored, and I've seen you many times. I'm a lifelong New Yorker, and you're a great live performer. So why don't you update us? I know you have a big tour coming up and a CD project. Tell us what's happening with Nona Hendrix.
Well, a lot of things. The most important, the Mutatis Mutandis CD release, actually the digital release is tomorrow. And then the physical release is the 31st of July. And I'm doing my East Coast dates starting the 12th in Somerville at Johnny D's, just outside of Boston. Then I play New York, Philadelphia, Long Island, D.C., and Connecticut. So I'll be doing some dates until the end of July. Then I play Lincoln Center as a tribute to Laura Nehru. It's an anniversary. Sarah Dash and I will be doing some of the songs from the Gonna Take a Miracle album. And then I fly off to Europe to do some dates there with Lou Reed.
Oh, that's great. And this Saturday, you're going to be at B.B. King's in the heart of Times Square. Beautiful venue.
Yes, B.B. King's on the 14th of July. So if anybody's in that area, come out and get some funk and some rock.
That's right. That's right. And August 11 is the tribute to Laura Nehru. And the Lincoln Center Out of Doors Festival is a world-class festival. I've been there a zillion times. Tell us what the music of Laura Nehru means to you.
Well, Laura was a friend, first of all. And it was really a great time of our career as LaBelle, with Patty and Sarah spending time with Laura. She became the fourth LaBelle. And we used to hang out, and Patty would cook, and we would eat, and we would sing. And then Laura asked us to sing with her on the Gonna Take a Miracle album. And we did, and then we toured with her for quite a while. So it was great. We just became really good friends, and, you know, really, she was just a great songwriter, a magical performer, and a really lovely person.
And she was just inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and it was very touching.
Yeah.
Her son came up and, accepted the award and gave a speech, and it was very moving, very moving.
Yeah, I mean, you know, she died very young, and, you know, to us who are older, she died very young. And she's missed, her voice is missed in music. I mean, she is on the same level to me as a Joni Mitchell, who I also think is one of the greatest female writers or writers of our time. And, or Carole King, I mean, you know, Laura had her own voice of in music, and it's missed because it was very different.
And some of the songs, I could throw out lyrics to tons of her songs, and I'm not even a performer. I mean, she wrote so many classic songs for the Fifth Dimension and all the major stars of that period.
Chicago.
Sure.
Yeah.
And I just don't quite understand, like, you know, music fans, that they'll always know a Carole King, they'll always know a Joni Mitchell, but her name is not quite as well known. Why is that?
Well, Laura was also very, she didn't cover such a wide scale, you know, whereas Carole King was much more of a pop music writer for pop groups and girl groups and guys. And Joni was, you know, her relationship through, what was it, the Crosby, Stills, Nash, you know, that relationship. I think that made her name go wider, and Joni is gonna, you know, she's still here, been around longer, and I think that allowed her to build a you know, take up all of that space, whereas Laura was really, her audience was very specific to Laura. She was not, she may have written for other people, but she didn't really publicize herself as that, you know. She was very introverted and not kind of out there in that way.
Interesting, interesting. And I'm looking forward to this show. It's such a great lineup. As you said, Sarah Dash and Desmond Child. And
Melissa Manchester.
Wow. Should be a great event. That's Saturday, August 11th at the Lincoln Center Out of Doors Fest. And
that's
tell us
free.
And that's free, right? Yeah.
Yeah. It's a great venue.
Oh, absolutely. And tell us a little about your new CD.
Well, if you like politics and you like social conversation, you'll like the CD. It came about because over the time since the World Trade Center bombing and the Iraqi war and all the things that have happened that our country, to our country, by our country, there were things that I really felt that I needed, wanted to write about and express my thoughts on. And then there were people, you know, like Rush Limbaugh and people and you know, some of the people involved in Tea Party and just the things that were going on that I felt a need to address. And so I did. I wrote songs. There's a song called The Tea Party, a song called The Ballad of Rush Limbaugh. There's a song called Oil on the Water, which deals with the oil spill in the Gulf. And, you know, there's also different things like black-on-black violence, you know, young kids, teenagers killing each other, which is, you know, I'm concerned about these things. And I try to put them in a music that isn't preaching, but having a conversation and touching on the issues. And then, you know, the overall song that wraps it all up is called Let's Give Love a Try, which is really something that, you know, after all this stuff that we do, that ultimately maybe what we should do is give love a try.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. This country is so divided, particularly as we approach the election. And every week I discuss this Mitt Romney, who's a corporate raider who put tens of thousands of people out of work. And somehow, you know, they twist this into he's going to be the job creator. It's almost comical. I don't understand how people – well, I do understand, because when people hear things often enough, they believe it's true, even if it's insane.
Yeah.
And I'm glad you're speaking out.
Well, you know, I think, you know, going back and, you know, the time that I've been in music and been growing, that a lot of musicians had a lot more to say, you know, really in their music about issues that were going on. And I think we kind of lost the plot as artists, that we don't get out there and be vocal about our politics, about our social issues, our social ills, the good things that are happening as well. And, you know, so you don't find that so much in pop theater music, as it is called. So I just felt that, you know, this is a place that I, you know, it touches a place in me that I want to write and express about. And it's always been kind of a part of my music, even with LaBelle, that, you know, people know us for Lady Marmalade, Bully Bukushevik, Masa Swa, but we also had songs like The System, Why Do You Keep Messing With My Mind? You know, there's endless, you know, What Can I Do For You? There's so many songs that we were talking about that our audience really loved to come in here and be a part of. You know, and we did it in a way that people could enjoy, they could get up and dance to it if they wanted to, but you also were able to take something away to think about.
Absolutely. And we just lost Gil Scott-Heron, and there's not a lot of guys like that out there, you know, anymore.
No. And, you know, yes, Mitt Romney's going to create jobs. He's going to create jobs for the wealthy.
Yeah.
That's his job creation. So, you know, he's not lying when he says he's going to, you know, create jobs, but it's just who they're going to be created for. And it's not, you know, I'm not really one party or the other. I'm really for, you know, the majority. And the majority are the ones who are not being heard.
Exactly. I mean, yeah. the... the term is they're representatives, but who are they representing? They're representing the corporations. They're not representing the working people. And what's going to trickle down, unfortunately, our unemployment checks. That's what's going to trickle down.
Yeah, so. And it's, you know, it's, and I, you know, I agree with you, and there's so much within our system that is wrong. We do have a great country and a great democracy, but it has been so destroyed by, you know, the people who get into power and forget how they got there and why they got there.
Yeah, well, they're thinking of the re-election in a couple of years, and they're thinking of which corporations are going to give them the most money, and the money that both Mitt Romney and Barack Obama are collecting is obscene.
Yeah.
You know,
it's crazy. It's crazy. That money could be put into education, could be put into health care, could be put into roads. I mean, I'm sitting on a street in New York right now that, you know, it's like a roller coaster because the roads are so bad. And that money that's going to be spent to say, vote for me, is really insane.
Yeah, send everybody $1,000 tax rebate instead. You know, really.
Just buy a vote, you know.
Exactly, exactly.
You may as well do that. Like, send me the money that I now have to pay in taxes anyway. And, you know, say, vote for me because I'm giving you $1,000. Yeah, and that's how ridiculous our system has become. And I really think we do need that. That's the first thing that needs to be changed, is that you vote your conscience, not to vote on promises.
Exactly. And in New York, you know, everything is the real estate industry. I mean, they're paying off the politicians. The rents are obscene and the housing prices are obscene. And it's very, very hard, the average working person. And so we're glad that you're speaking out, because not a lot of artists are. So,
well, I don't think I could sleep well at night without really caring about my community, my country, the people who are in it, you know, and because everything affects, each one of us affects the other. And I think the idea that we live in some sort of vacuum, separated from whatever else is going on in our community and in our country and in the world, is really a very blind vision. You know, whatever, if there's crime, and I try to avoid crime by sectioning it off and buying a bigger house somewhere else, it only increases the crime because they're going to come to where I live to take what I have. And I don't think these people understand that you cannot have a huge, vast majority of poor and a small minority of wealthy and think that how you live is not going to be affected by it.
Absolutely. And I'll make this brief because it's really about you. I get very tired of the whole anti-immigrant sentiment also in this country. You know, realize who your enemies are. Your enemies are the corporations, Wall Street, the banks. It's not some poor guy struggling to survive. The whole anti-immigrant sentiment, it just horrifies me, just really.
Yeah, well, you know, this is a country of immigrants, the majority.
What? Of course.
You know, in my song, The Tea Party, a couple of the lines are, she can't speak English as good as me party, you know, and also, you know, the fact that they want to take the country back, and don't they know it wasn't theirs, and that's a fact. You know, this is just truth, and I don't know, either people are so removed from reality they have really all drank all the Kool-Aid that they don't see these things as the truth.
Well, Dick Gregory, who played at B.B. King's just yesterday, he says that he reads 8 or 9 newspapers a day, you know, conservative, liberal, you know, whatever, and he makes his own opinion. If you only watch Fox TV, you are drinking from that Kool-Aid. So you're absolutely right.
True. Yeah. Well, Fox News is not news. it's, you know, it's fantasy. And unfortunately, a lot of what's considered news in America is not news. I primarily watch the BBC for news. I tape it and watch it because they actually report on a story. You know, they don't give you the sound bite. They report on the story. And so I get more information about what's going on in Afghanistan, in Pakistan, in Turkey, in Syria, in all these other places, in the Philippines, and some places where there's stuff going on that Americans don't even know is going on that can come and bite us tomorrow. Because we're not informed. And to me, that's one of the biggest problems in America, is that we don't get real news and that we are not informed as individuals.
Oh, absolutely. People, they watch their American Idol and they watch their reality series and they watch sports and they really don't know what's going on. And they go, Mitt Romney has good hair and good teeth and he's a handsome guy and I'm going to vote for him. I mean, you know, come on.
Yeah, I'm laughing, but it's really sad.
It is.
That's really a sad state.
Absolutely. And I have my co-host, Dr. Mike Lano, who's been patiently waiting to ask you questions. Dr. Mike.
Well, a couple
Hello,
of things.
Dr. Mike. Too,
hi. I'm out here. I just live outside of Oakland, so I'm very sensitive to everything that you're saying and approve of all of it.
Yeah.
But one thing, too, well, we need a moratorium on the ad stuff and blowing all of this money that could be going to help poor people, people that are hungry and starving and their homes are being taken away. But before I forget, I was a huge fan of Laura Nyro's voice. Obviously, she was a genius at her creation and her craft. But don't forget, Barbra Streisand made one of her songs super famous, too, besides Fifth Dimension. And ultimate legend. So we were all really happy that she was deservedly honored. One thing, too, amongst all of the great stuff that you do is, besides LaBelle, weren't you in Artists United Against Apartheid, which was a big deal in the 80s?
Yes, definitely, with Bono, Vernon Reed, Lou Reed, a lot of different artists, because, no, I wasn't going to play Sun City while apartheid was still in place.
That was a famous anthem on MTV. I forgot how many people you might have been part of the group Not Gonna Play Sun City. I don't know if Bruce Springsteen was involved, but...
Yes, Bruce Springsteen.
So real to all of us. Tell us a little, because I forgot, amongst all of the many things you do and all of the things you do to improve the planet... And you know, all the musical craft and the great fashion sense that you brought, again, globally. But you were also an author and an actress. Tell us a little about that. I wasn't aware of that, if that's true.
No, that is true. And it's not something that I was really pursuing. I became an author by wanting to write something for my nieces and nephews who... When I would go to stores to find something that was black identified in terms of books, because I would always buy them books or things that were educational, and it was very hard to find anything. And I also saw that there was always, when it came to something that had to do with black or dark, it was always identified as negative. So I wanted to write something that talked about darkness as positive. In terms of night, we need the night because we sleep, we restore ourselves, it's nurturing. The earth is dark, it's nurturing. You know, so I wrote a book for them and some music to go with it. And as an actress, I was working with a friend on a project and he asked me to do one of the roles and to sing a song and to write music. And I was writing music for the film. And for theater, a theater piece that he was doing, and that's how I became an actress. In, you know, tiny little roles, but acting is not my forte.
Well, but that's terrific. That just shows your talent knows no ends. Yeah, that's still disturbing. In 2012, if you go into a toy store, you watch ads for toys on kids' TV, very few are geared towards African American or Hispanic or Asian people, which is obscene. And even books, when you go into the few remaining whatever bookstores and you go to the children's book section, very few. I mean, it's all Lily White, which is ridiculous.
Well, it's mainly because things have become so, in a way, segregated in that, you know, if you want something black, you go to the black neighborhood. If you want something Hispanic, you go to the Hispanic or the Asian or the, you know. And although we are a huge melting pot as a country, we are polarized in our different sort of racial sections of a city. We come together in our workplace or things like that, but then we go home to our individual territory, which keeps us separated, although we're living in the same city. That has a lot to do with politics and housing and social issues that, you know, if I wanted to buy a condo or an apartment in a certain building in New York, I would have to go through like this whole laundry list of questions and being investigated and all kinds of stuff before I could possibly get in. That's, you know, it just is still there, and it just takes a long, long, long time to undo these issues that have been with us for a long time.
It's ridiculous. Last two things. Well, that's why any on the Republican side, criticism of our president is insane because A, he inherited all those messes from Bush. B, any positive things he tries to do, the in bulk or in mass in Congress and the House of Representatives and the Senate, all of that stuff, they try to defeat all that stuff. So they don't allow him to do anything good that they would probably support if it was one of their own guys, which is just crazy. And then they say, well, you know, look, he hasn't done anything, which they're the cause. They're the reason he isn't doing as many things as he would like to do. He's done, it's amazing he's done as much as he has with the Republicans have split off. But musically, I wanted to ask, oh, go ahead.
I was going to say that's true. And I have to say, you know, which is really insane because it's like cutting off your nose to spite your face. You hurt your country by not chipping in and doing your part, which is what you're, you know, sent there to do, to represent the people. And I also have to say for the Democratic Party, you know, that once Barack Obama won, I think they went, you know, and the Democratic Party won the presidency. I think Democrats went to sleep or something, or they were partying and forgot that the Tea Party was coming and lost, you know, the seats in that next election. So we have to take some responsibility as a Democrat for where we stand today.
Yeah, we got to get tough because they're loaded with weaponry. Last question, though, is...
Yeah.
When I watch, for example, I mean, I'm watching, we're talking about watching Centric and BET and all of this stuff. I've got to go if I want to see the music I love, which I think Evan loves, classic R&B and soul. And seeing Patti LaBelle, I can't remember if you guys were all together when she did one of those PBS things where they had all of these great artists. And I know music is suffering because of, you know, the corp stuff and the internet and people don't make albums as such. You know, it's more today's music industry just sort of hits me as I'm frustrated. It in some ways is very depressing for artists and seeing who's selling all of these records, comedic acts or young white kids trying to do rap. Where are the great songs? Where are the artists? You know, very few and far between. Not like in the 70s and 80s when we had just a bonanza, a wealth of incredible talent. And I just don't see that nowadays. And I don't know where the music industry is headed. Do you have any thoughts?
Well, I think where it's headed is that it's fallen apart, which is probably a good thing because, you know, it had gotten so overblown and so inflated that it had to implode, which is what happened. Now, I think you'll see that coming, you know, not that particular thing, but a new version coming together. There are people out there who are still singing, you know, soul R&B. I mean, I listen to Anthony Hamilton, you know. I listen to Calvin Richardson. I listen to, you know, people from that side. Most of them are male singers. There aren't that many female singers new who are coming from that place. Hopefully that will change. And so I think that it's there, but it's a small band of people. And because the industry has become, you know, this fractured entity, it's very hard to find. There's no sort of main stream of these people or a stream that they can come through. That has to come back in terms of having some sort of central entity that would be the music business.
Well, I'll throw to Evan, but I think I speak for the whole planet thanking you for all the great music you have and you continue to produce, and I know you'll do more of.
Thank you very much. I want to continue to make music that moves hearts and minds and booties.
There you go. And I've seen you perform many, many times in New York, and what you do is really a mix of rock and R&B, I would say. And why is it that radio is so rigid, as you know, with formats? Why does something have to be pure R&B or have to be rock? For example, I just saw Fishbone just a couple of days ago, and I love those guys, but it's hard for them to get airplay.
Yeah, it's been hard their whole career, and same way it's been hard for me, and you know. Anybody who, yeah, I think kind of, it's always been the same kind of thing. You know, like you had Jimi Hendrix, you had Sly Stone, you had Prince, you had Living Color, you had Lenny Kravitz. And it's very, like, every now and then somebody comes through. I mean, like the band Mother's Finest. I mean, one of the funkiest killer bands. Joyce Kennedy's one of the great singers. You know, everybody knows Chaka Khan, but nobody, you know, hardly knows Joyce Kennedy. And Joyce is, like, bad. So it's just that, you know, there's on both sides, on the black audience, they don't, you know, always want to get down with a funky or harder kind of music. And on the white side, you know, you've got this like pop, squeaky clean, you know, boy band, girl band, whatever, catering to like this teen demographic, because I guess that's where the money is. And that's what how it's been divided. And unfortunately, all the rest of us, me included, we work on the fringe, and now and again, somebody pops through.
And I also think it borders on the criminal, the ageism in the music industry, how you have tremendous, tremendous artists, and if they're not extremely young, it's hard for them to get that airplay, which, you know, is insane, absolutely insane as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, and that's kind of always been there. You know, you had the Bobby Soxers, that whole thing. That's been there, and that's going to be there, because teenagers, is always a new crop every kind of like 4 years or whatever to be catered to, and that's fine, because their ears aren't old enough to hear this other music, and I don't mean lyrically, but they just don't have the time in life, in terms of having lived long enough to really understand this other music. You know, when they discover it, when they get like 17, 18, maybe, you know, or in college. Right. So, you know, I think everybody, every group of people, you know, there's music for them. I just think the problem is the exclusion. And radio in other countries, and specifically in England, the BBC plays Frank Sinatra and the Red Hot Chili Peppers and One Direction, and, you know, Nicki Minaj. Everybody is on that station, right?
Yeah.
That's the biggest station in the country, and that's what we're missing.
Absolutely. I was in Paris last summer with my wife, and I'm watching TV, and they'll go from hip-hop to Afrobeat to jazz to rock,
right.
And it doesn't matter as long as it's all good, and that's really the way it should be.
Yep. If you want to talk about an underserved area group, let's talk about jazz, you know. So that's one of our problems, and maybe, you know, with this implosion of a music industry, i.e. affecting radio and everything else, and with your show and, you know, more internet radio, and maybe, you know, what's reformed, there will be an American version of the BBC Radio 1 in America, like America 1 or something.
I certainly hope so, because it's
tough. And I hope you're on it.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you so much. I'm going to throw a question totally from left field. Out of all your work, my favorite song is Baby Go-Go. I love George Clinton. I love Mavis Staples. Tell us a little about that song. That's a great song.
Well, you know, I met Prince like pre him becoming successful in Minneapolis. And, you know, was kind of in contact, stayed in contact, really. And when I was making this record with Dan Hartman, who's also one of the great producers, songwriters who have been unsung in our industry, really close friend who died quite a few years ago. And Dan and I were making this record, and I wanted to do something with Prince, and Prince was in the middle of something, so he said, you know, I've got this song I want to send you, and it was Baby Go-Go, and I started working on it, and I was thinking, who would I want to do this song with me, and George Clinton used to cut my hair, so
in
New Jersey. Yeah, he was a hairstylist, so this is way back in the day, you know, before he became George Clinton people.
Yeah.
And Mavis Staples, I've known since the days of playing the Apollo Theater and the Uptown Theater, all the Chitlin Circuit and Pops and the whole family. And we were really close. And I asked her, and she said, yeah, Montana, I'll be there. What you want? So that's how that came together. And, you know, Dan just did a great job working with me on it.
Oh, yeah, great, great song. I still enjoy it. And it's like 25 years later. Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Great. Thank you.
Oh, you got it. And Ms. Hendricks, please take the next few minutes and plug anything you want to plug. The next few minutes are yours.
Okay. My last word is that for all those people who hear this and are in Somerville, come to Johnny D's, or Boston, come to Johnny D's, come to B.B. King's on the 4th. Johnny D's is on the 12th of this coming Friday, I think that is, and then B.B. King's on the 14th, and Philadelphia on the 15th, Washington, D.C., U Street on the 17th, and then the 20th in Connecticut at Cafe 9, and then Old Neil Inn on the 21st in Long Island. Oh, I missed out the World Cafe in Philadelphia. So,
there you go.
Yeah, everybody who can hear us, come on out, bring your mind, bring your butt. We'll get down, we'll get funky, we'll get educated. And don't forget my CD coming out, Matadas Matandas, and this is my Woman's Bill of Rights tour.
Wow. And they will get educated as well. So it's entertainment and education. There you go.
Right. And I also forgot, all those who can hear us, go to Pledge Music. Go to www.pledgemusic.com/artist, A-R-T-I-S-T-S, / Nona Hendricks, and pledge, and you can get the CD early, or you can get some of my artwork, or you can get my book, or you can get meet and greet with me, sit down, talk with me, that kind of stuff.
That's great. Support great music and education. And Ms. Hendricks, this just popped into my head. I must ask this. You've been, you know, so important in the music industry for quite a while now. What would you tell a young artist coming up? What warning would you give them? What advice would you give them?
The advice I would give them is that if it's what you have to do, if it's something that you are so passionate about that you believe that it is your vocation, and that means it's your calling to work every day that you're awake on reaching one person, and from that one person to another person, get on the road, play, gig as often as you can, because your audience will tell you whether it's good or whether it's not good.
There you go. That should about do it. Ms. Hendricks, it's such an honor and a pleasure having you on the show, and we wish you nothing but the best in the future. And I urge anyone who has not seen Nona Hendricks to go out live and experience her, because it's something special.
Thank you.
I mean that sincerely. I really do.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for appearing on Legends Radio. Really do appreciate it.
The Tea Party. T stands for Trouble Party. The Tea Party.
The Tea Party.
The Me Party.
The Me Party.
The Tea Party.
The Tea Party.
It's all about Me Party.
The Me Party.
The Tea Party.
The Tea Party.
The Me Party.
The Me Party.
They said he can't be a he or she a he party. The No Party.
The No Party.
The Hell No Party.
The Hell No Party.
But don't you know that there's a hell below party? The steel part, the shoot to kill part. I said, brother, can you be for real part? Don't play the fool. The castration of a nation on the radio and TV station. They say they wanna take their country back, but don't they know it?
The tea party.
It's all about me part.
The me part.
The tea party.
The tea
part. The old part.
The old part.
The tea party.
The tea part.
The remote control part.
The control part.
I said, don't they know there's a hell below part? The tea part.
The tea part.
The me part.
The me part.
They said she can speak English as good as me part. The old part.
The
castration of a nation
All right, we are back with Legends Radio. And when you talk legends, who's bigger than Julie Newmar and Nona Hendrix? How's that for two big names in one show, Dr. Mike?
It's pretty incredible. Well, you know, we have fun with them. I was just really impressed with Nona Hendrix. I think she's a great human being, humanitarian, all of those things. Tremendous person. Both of them are. Both are people that contribute to improving the planet, and we have so many people that don't. So it was, Nona Hendrix has just done so many great things in her life.
Absolutely. And we have had and will have tons of huge names right here on Legends Radio. So if you are an advertiser or a sponsor, consider reaching a worldwide audience, 20 or so countries. We have thousands of listeners in the Netherlands. We have a nice audience in China. And we have two fans in Yemen, right? Right, Rick, the producer? I don't know if Rick's even listening.
Yeah, see, but I used to get this great intro, and now I'm just Rick the producer. Yes, there are people listening all across the world to Legends Radio, and why don't you tell your friends? I always tell you, tell a friend. You used to say that, Evan, right? Tell a friend to tell a friend, or what was that?
Tell a friend to tell a friend about Legends Radio, but let's do better. Tell a friend to tell a friend to spend some money in the Legends Radio store. How's that? We have a store, folks. So,
buy a book, a picture. There's some good stuff in there. There's a lot of good stuff in there. It's old stuff, new stuff. There's a lot of good stuff.
Well, give this guy a plug. You were just saying, is it whose website is this great wrestling artist? Showman, Shoman, art.com? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, his name's Evan Showman. He started out doing a lot of MMA artists, artwork, and of course he does a show called Tap Out Radio, which I've been producing almost as long as I produce this, Evan. So he's been around a long time doing that, and he's very, very famous for doing it. Unfortunately, being an artist, he don't make much. And isn't that the way things are? It's the most talented people don't make money.
He's not making the big money like Dr. Mike and I are on that radio.
He reminds me a lot of you. He reminds me a lot of you, Evan, because he's got to beg, borrow, and steal to get people to buy his wonderful artwork. And it's a shame because the stuff's great. I'm actually buying a frame to put it on my wall right now. So
I only have one thing to say. Did anybody's graydar go off last week when Anderson Cooper finally admitted he's gray?
Gay.
Well, gray. G-R-A-Y. I'm just.
What I heard, and this is just allegedly, right, Evan, so you can give your disclaimer after I say this, is that the reason why he had come out is because someone was going to out him.
Oh, God. Who cares anymore? It doesn't matter. Nobody cares. Everybody should do their own thing. Although, in that vein, I have to ask, with this horrific, just these shills that have so little honesty or integrity, ABC has launched, you know, after giving the quick brush off to their show, The Revolution, in the afternoon, which replaced a well-loved soap opera. But Good Afternoon America opens up, and their lead guest is Liza Minnelli. Evan, what on earth has happened to Liza Minnelli? She's lisping. I know you age, so I'll be sensitive to that. She's not the cute Liza from the 60s and 70s who was a beautiful girl and very talented performer. I don't know what on earth has happened to her. She's a mess.
Well, she's certainly not a kid anymore.
But I mean, we could, you know, overlook that and take in the natural.
In fact, Wikipedia says she was born in 1946, which my pitiful math that would be 66 years old, I believe. And
she lists. She just seems like she's not mentally there. It's sort of like.
I wouldn't go that far.
Well, this is my opinion, but I'm just saying she lisps, and it's just like she's in a fog. And there are a lot of people Ernest Borgnine was the same the guy was 95, and he was really no different than he was 60 years ago. So I don't know what on earth she did to herself, but it's just a shame. When you look at, I know she's a gay icon and she's a legend, but speaking of legends, on a more positive note, just changing the subject quickly. On Turner Classic Movie, they've been airing all the Dick Tracy movie serials. And the very first one, who is the lead heel as Splitface?
Liza Minnelli.
Well, it could be.
No, I just made that up.
Mike Mazurki was the wrestler actor who founded Cauliflower Alley Club, but Mike Mazurki was tremendous. Remember, he was in Mighty Joe Young when they had the wrestling pull apart segment with the super Swedish Angel and all those guys. Primo Carnera.
Wow. Well, I honestly don't remember that because I saw it when I was a kid. But I want you to know, on the topic of Liza, I was watching a PBS documentary on Judy Garland around 4 a.m. the other night. And I said to myself, I bet Evan is the only straight guy in America watching a Judy Garland documentary at 4 a.m.
No, I watched it because it's heartbreaking. She looked like an old woman when she died, and she was forced by the studios and Louis Mayer to do all those drugs to stay thin and to stay awake, which is churning out movies. And it's just criminal. She had a great voice. She was a phenomenal actress, all of those great things. Looked like an old woman, and she was like 47. Awful.
I will never, ever forget when I was a kid in 1967, my dad was a cab driver. He picked up Judy Garland in the cab, and he said to me, he has never seen somebody look so bad. She'll be dead within a year. And, you know, she was a big, big star. I mean, huge. And in fact, in the documentary, they say she was the greatest performer of the 20th century, of the entire century. And it hit me, you know, it hit me. Wow. And a few months later, the woman was dead, you know, 47 years old. She looked like an old woman. It was rough. But I know Rick, our engineer, wants to add something. Our beloved engineer. I have to give him a proper intro. Yeah.
Firstly, I don't get my hair cut by George Clinton.
Yeah.
Also, I'm looking around the studio and noticing I have a lot of nice stuff, and I'd really like you, Evan, if you could give that famous disclaimer, if you could, because I'm getting awfully nervous with some of the things that are being said by Dr. Mike.
No, right. I'll say it. The opinions expressed are go ahead, Evan.
The opinions expressed are not necessarily shared or endorsed by yours truly or our engineer producer Rick Hendrickson. So, if Liza Minnelli is a Nona Hendrix fan and tuned in, Dr. Mike's saying it. We're not.
No, I think we all want to see Liza Minnelli healthier. We want to see her live to a natural old age of like 90. And we just want the best for her. I just wish she was the Liza Minnelli of the 60s and 70s, you know. And she's been through an awful lot, to her credit, you know, that last marriage, all of that stuff. I mean, you got to give her – maybe you look at it that way. She's a trooper, and she's carried on, and thank God she's far outlived her mother when a lot of people didn't know and if she would and had hope. And, we all want to see her survive and be healthier than she is now. But she's been through the ringer, as many women in entertainment. And I saw her, actually, she had the sub for Dean Martin when he dropped out of the Rat Pack. They were touring, I forget what year it was, 86. Sinatra and Sammy and her, you know, I was disappointed, of course, that Dean Martin was going to be a part of it. But she still had it then.
Well, I want you to know, I saw her a few years ago in Brooklyn in front of probably 5,000 people, and she was just great. She was tremendous, absolutely tremendous. So, and this was not a long, long time ago. So, and my friend saw her on Broadway and raved about her. So, you know, everybody has an off day, Dr. Mike. I don't know where you saw her or what show it was. But
she had a stroke, perhaps, something like that. But I saw Anne Margaret in her day, and she could still in Vegas, and she could still really perform the way Liza could. Liza was one of the biggest drawing, not just movies and the classic TV concerts she did, which are a huge deal, and I think PBS has been replaying those. But she was a tremendous one-woman show. I mean, and you would see her, and she gave so much of herself, 150%. She would be just sweating bullets at the very end. Like, you know, the top performers, when they're just working as hard as they can, and giving it, you know, their all. And that was Liza Minnelli. And
well, you know, you're talking in the past tense, and I'm talking in the present tense, because I saw her not that long ago, and she was just tremendous. So, you know, I just go by what I've seen with my own eyes, and, you know.
Well, that's good.
Yeah, she did a run on Broadway not all that long ago, and people raved about it. So, you know, I guess the trick would be to see her live, Dr. Mike, and see what you think. My favorite performer of all time is Al Green, and he runs hot and cold on stage. I mean, you'll see him some nights. You go, this is the greatest show on planet Earth. I'm blessed to be here. And then you'll see him at another show, where it's like a sing-along with the audience, you know, Bill the plumber and, you know, Dan the delivery man, he's singing more than Al Green, and, you're kind of kicking yourself for buying a ticket. So, you know, you hit a certain age, and sometimes the consistency may not be there, but I'll tell you,
he's in the neck of the woods. In fact, I'm trying to get him, probably a long shot, but he's going to be doing a number of dates out here, like Montalvo Arts Center, etc., and then San Francisco proper. But the very thing you're saying about, he was reviewed in our paper today, and not reviewed, but somebody did a phone interview with him before he comes out here, and the guy said, everybody sings your songs in the shower. Whose songs do you sing when you're in the shower? And he goes, everybody else's. So he's a very witty guy, and he talks about a lot of the rough times, and I guess arriving wherever he was with just three songs to his name, including I'm So Tired of Being Alone, which is autobiographical. His girlfriend was working a night shift and would get home at like 3 or 4 in the morning, and we'd never see her, and he was lonely. And that's where that great song came from, his first big national hit.
Yeah, Al, some of the best nights of my life have been seeing this guy, and he's playing New York in August. And Maxwell's playing in August. Maxwell is also great. And Millie Jackson returns to New York August 4th, I believe, at B.B. King's. So the great Millie Jackson, also one of my favorites. I'm an R&B guy. I mean, I like anything that's good. In fact, I spent most of the past 2 days editing my upcoming music documentary, which I direct and produce and appear in The Stage is an Altar. And my other documentary that I produced, Teresa Sario Alive Again, you could keep up with us at aliveagainmovie.com. And I just want to remind everybody that Legends Radio has its own Facebook page. So if you want to like us, friend us, whatever, you know, please do. And you'll be the first one to know what's happening with our all-star lineups that we have pretty much each and every week. So Legends Radio, from coast to coast, we give you the most. And YouTube, Legends Radio is now on YouTube as well. And we'd like to thank our hardworking engineer, Rick Hendrickson, for getting us a YouTube presence as well. So Legends Radio, we are not hard to find. And Evan Ginsburg, EvanGinzburg, not hard to find. I'm at Facebook, MySpace, LinkedIn, Twitter, everywhere imaginable. So not too difficult to get in touch with yours truly. And, of course, you can do it through the website as well. And we're going to really shift gears from the arts with Julie Newmar and Nona Hendricks to pro wrestling, which is also one of our favorites, the proletarian performance art, as the late great DJ Fred Geobold used to say. And we will be right back with indie star Jorge Santi. We will be right back, folks.
Hey, let's to do it right. Somebody say, we gotta build up and keep it rising. Don't let nobody talk you into compromising. All we can do if we only, if we only do it right. Somebody say, faith is knowing, faith is believing. All you do is smile at me and I stop breathing. All we can do if we only, if we only do it right. Somebody say, let's give the love a try. We gotta build the and keep it rising. Don't let nobody talk you into compromising. All we can do if we only, if we only do it right. Say, let's give the love a try. You wanna kill me, kill me with kindness. Let me go down and drown in the sea of love from blindness. All we can do if we only do it right. Say, let's give a love a try. Bring me your anger, but linger safe in my arms. And stars will still shine. Love's not a prison. Love's wisdom will help you rise above fear and believe and trust. All we can do if we only, if we only do it right.
Evan Ginsberg back with Legends Radio, and we have on the line a great New York-based indie wrestler representing the FWE. He is Jorge Santi. How are you tonight, Jorge?
I'm good. Feeling a little congested, but I'm great. How are you?
As a allergy sufferer, I know what it's like to be congested as well, so I empathize.
Thank you.
There you go. Jorge, tell us a little about yourself. The FWE is a great promotion. I've attended a few of their cards, and AJ Pan is a good buddy of both of ours. Tell us about FWE, and tell us about Jorge as well.
Cool. FWE is a great event, family wrestling entertainment, very family-oriented. due to past events where a lot of people use the curse, but it is a very family-oriented show. They come out of Manhattan, New York, and they've been pulling on a great show since day one, since last year. And they're doing their thing. This show coming up, the FWE, they have a College Place High School. The event is in Long Island. Some of the proceeds will go and benefit the Multiple Sclerosis Research Fund Foundation also as well. So that's a good thing, you know, and they're always looking to improve. They had bullying campaigns going on and stuff for, people who get bullied and stuff. So it's doing good. It's really running well, and it lives up to its own hype.
And they've had great names on this shows. I know Tommy Dreamer is regularly featured, and I've seen Jay Lethal there. And tell us a little about some of the talent that comes out. Yeah, Charlie Haas is a tremendous worker. Yeah. Tell us about some of the other talent that FWE has.
This amazing talent. You guys, you couldn't even pick a better card. Like, you got guys that are on the indies trying to make it. These guys are not hungry. They're starving to make it, and I'm one of them. I'm happy to be a part of these cards. You got Tommy Dreamer, a legend. You got Carlito. He comes around. He's really good. And all these people you get to know, Davari and stuff. They're class act. You learn, especially that they've been where you want to go. So you get to learn from them a little more. So. Yeah, the cards are great. You got Jay Lethal.
As an indie wrestler, how do you feel when you see a CM Punk and yesterday an Austin Aries who became the TNA champion? How do you feel when you see great indie wrestlers climb their way to the top of the business? What kind of inspiration does that give to you?
It gives me a lot of inspiration because these guys come from places, like what, CM Punk's from Chicago, and from what other interviews you hear from him, he talks about his life, it's coming up, he was poor and all that, he had to deal with family issues, and he overcome and achieved that. Same thing, with Austin Aries, he's another one, up-and-comer, and back in like 04, 05, and you watch him transform on TV, and now he's like one of the greatest. Like they're out there doing their thing, and they're showing people that it doesn't matter how tall you are, it doesn't matter how skinny, you could do it no matter what, and it gives me gives me a big push, and I like to know that these people came from the same background as I am.
Yeah, and you don't have to be 6'4", 300 pounds to make it today, which is great. It's great news. It gives a lot of people hope.
Yeah.
And Jorge, FWE, I've noticed as well, has a very strong women's division, which is unusual in the indies. Tell us a little about that.
They're very strong. They're very, amazing. I don't know. To me, I guess TV waters them down, and you don't really get to see what they can really do. And these girls go at it. They make sure not only you get your $25 worth, you get almost $40 worth. They're really good. Like, there are times when, this is my ignorance when I was growing up. Like, women's matches, let me change the channel. But, now I get to see them up close and personal, and I guess it's the indie area, they show what they got other than what they were supposed to show people on TV. And it's amazing. Winter, Maria, Lita Lita, the names go on and on. Rosita comes around. She's a good friend of mine. She's cool.
There you go. And like I said, I've attended FWE cards, and I was very impressed.
They're amazing.
By how smoothly they run, very professional, family-oriented, and appropriately named FWE, Family Wrestling Entertainment.
It's toned down, though. I think it's toned down the cursing and stuff. Because I guess when you go into a fight, you get excited and, you really want to show what, these people that are paying $20, $25 tickets, $30, what you got. So there are times you get a little excited and, you curse here and there.
Well, I have no problem with strong language, but at the same time, sometimes we refer to it as cheap heat. You know,
a
true heel can get the fans aggravated without resorting to it. You know, anyway, we have Dr. Mike Leno in California, who's a true supporter of the Indies. Questions for Jorge, Mike.
Well, Jorge, I've covered the biz since '66, but I'm glad. Like Rosita, I think, isn't she the one of the two that wrestles regularly for CMLL? And they just had and it looked like our old. I was working for my home base territory was the LA Mike LaBelle '70s territory, and it looked like CMLL for an all girls battle royal with Rosita in it was using our old Blassie cage, this old wood. Classic wood and metal cage. So that's good to see. And obviously, I've always favored the, and there were a lot of territories in the old days, but I favor the lighter weights. Some like, this may not mean anything to you, the Leroy McGurk territory before Bill Watts took it over was a quote unquote smaller guys, but we knew that's where the real talent, the guys that could fly. Later on, Chavo and Mondo and Hector came in there. But it was guys that could fly, the Danny Hodges, all of these guys. And that's what is so uplifting about seeing, you know, even though they're stuck wrestling their style in either big company, Claudio in WWE or the stuff with Austin Aries and a lot of the great indie talent. Just really TNA has gotten away from like the stiff, clawed old farts that they'd been sort of spotlighted in the last 2 years. To now we see all these Zima Ion type guys, exciting guys, Sanjay Dutt coming back, who's a friend of the show and always a tremendous talent. The former Scorpius guy I was talking about, from SoCal, they had him wrestle under his real name. So the male and female, the real athletes, I don't want to see, and I hope I speak for everyone, like for the women, I don't want to see fitness models. You know, WWE is down to two legit lady wrestlers, Natty and Beth Phoenix. Hopefully they have Sarah Del Rey. But then, again, the negative part is she's going to be stuck working that style. And we've seen all the athleticism and all the great stuff she can do when she's just allowed to be herself. When you go to that company, they throw you into developmental, and they retrain you, and you have to work that slower, plotting, more predictable style. So the Indies are the best, not just bargain, but they're the best place to see people that are no limits. The real, you want to say no limits.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you agree? And the Indies, it just, you know, I think you're encouraged, I hope, no matter what indie it is, to just do the absolute best you can, not to step, you know, not to use this guy. You can't use this guy's finisher or that. Just go out there and do your best.
Yeah, that's Indies, like you said, it's like no holds bar in thoughts. You know, it's everything. It's all original. Well, sometimes it is all original, but you have complete control of what you want to do, how you want to do it, how you want to think, and how you want, even if you want to carry a story in your match, you know how to make it happen without anybody saying, well, you can't do that, you can't do this, you know, and that's what I like about indie wrestling. It's just, you know, like one day I would like to hopefully get signed somewhere and learn more of the craft, but also I would like to also know that I have this free lance on my own work.
Yeah, for example, I was there the first time a Hurricanrana ever occurred, and a wrestler, great Hispanic wrestler, Raul Mata, who was really put over and had a nice push in Los Angeles. He held a lot of titles before he, for whatever reason, moved to Florida, and then Eddie Graham was kind of using him as a jobber. But Raul Mata did what was called a Mata Rola that Dave Meltzer's written about. His home base was L.A. after he left Guadalajara. And that's what we know today as the Frankensteiner or Hurricane, you know, whatever. So, you know, it's, I like seeing, Evan was talking about this earlier. I like guys today, and, you know, we've watched all these great high spots going to the Spot Fest that was, let's see, Tiger Mask Original, Satoru Sayama, and Dynamite Kid. You know, those are pieces. That's really the true piece of art, where wrestling is art, came from. Yeah. But we want to see some psychology mixed with it. I love exactly. seeing the spots, but you've got to also have that other thing. And hopefully the Indies allows that. It sounds like from what you're saying, it does. It allows you to use the psychology too. High spots are great, but tie it together, bring it so it's more meaningful.
Like, I would like to see that also, because there are some guys out there who just, and maybe it's how they're trained, maybe it's how, you know, different they look at things, but there's no psychology to match it. They just go to move, and I don't like that. Like, I like a lot of art into my match. I like to show people, like, oh my God, he almost got him, you know, stuff like that. That's stuff that, you know, you want people to be on their feet for. You know, but, yeah, move after move, her karana into a backbreaker or something like that. Where's the psychology in that, you know? Us now, like, now that we're learning more of the psychology and stuff, it's better that, you know, we could retrain the fans. Instead of them being bloodthirsty, we could retrain them and showing them how, you know, we could still bring it back. You know, people say, oh, the 80s was the best wrestling ever and stuff. And you can say that, but also, you know, it also transforms through time. So you can say, oh, this is better. Like, it's like hip-hop. Oh, I like old-school hip-hop better. But then now, the new school hip hop, all you hear is Drake on the radio station. But you know, this is just preference. But like I said, we have to retrain the fans and show them. You know, listen, we kill each other, but also you have to watch our story, watch how we could perform. You know, there's people that don't perform the moves no more. They just go right into it.
I saw a match, ringside, Johnny Valentine against Jack Briscoe, and Valentine, his heel, had a headlock. They were laying on the mat, what you would call today a rest hold, and people would chant boring. But the facials and the heat was incredible, and Valentine held that for like 12 minutes, and the place was going nuts, and it wouldn't fly today, which is a real shame. You know, they constantly have to be in motion. And another thing for you great young guys is it kills me when I see like the lariat or suplex as transitions. Those were finishers. Yeah. Those were finishers. And
that's true.
Yeah, it's, you know, the lariat is just, I mean, God, you've seen it a million times, the clothesline / lariat, and no one gets up for it. And you can do these things and keep your career going. If you look at Thez, who wrestled in 7 decades, Blassie and Al Costello, Kangaroo Al Costello, for almost 7 decades, but they did 6. They use their head and they wrestled smartly, because you can't be doing high spots. You can't be doing the incredible Sabu stuff when you're 60. Yeah. Your body won't be able to handle it. And will your career be able to continue? So I'll get off that high horse and throw back to Evan.
So Jorge, you have it's true. There you go. Jorge, yes. You have a big match coming up with Joey Ace, I believe. Tell us about that.
Yes, Joey Ace. Yeah, that Scruff McGruff guy. Yeah, I'm going to re-wrestle him. He's a part of the team, Diamonds Incorporated. But, last show, Dysfunctional Family, I beat his no-neck partner, Jason Gotti. But it's going to be fun this time because, you know, I guess this guy is kind of trying to come back for, revenge for his partner. But I got him and his, cute girlfriend.
Okay. So that's a big match. And do you know offhand what the main event is on the next big show?
From what I heard, the main event will be, I think, a 4-way elimination with a FWE heavyweight title. It's Jay Lethal versus Carlito versus Tommy Dreamer versus Brian Kendrick.
Wow.
I
don't see that.
I know. I know, me too. I might have to the bleachers with the fans to mark out.
I'm totally jaded, and I just said wow. So I think I'm gonna try to get out to that show.
All these guys I have total respect for. They're really, you know, they're what indie should be. These guys are what indie should be.
Absolutely, and. Good guys also. Jay Lethal's always, you know, friendly and smiling.
Yeah, very nice.
It's nice to see when somebody hits the big time that they don't have an ego to go with it. You
exactly.
know, it's
he's also
pleasure.
A good singer.
Oh, really? Really?
Yeah. How about karaoke days? Hold on.
Wow, we have to get him on the show because we have some of the best singers. We just had Nona Hendricks from LaBelle on a couple of minutes ago.
All right, awesome.
Yeah, we have some of the greatest singers in history on this show. Hey, you mentioned hip hop. Are you a hip hop fan?
Yeah, I'm underground hip hop. Right now I'm into Childish Gambino. You ever heard of that guy?
Oh yeah. We just had a 3 hour plus indie hip hop show on Legends Radio.
If you go back two, three weeks,
yeah, check it out.
I'll check out the archives.
Yeah, we're tapped into the New York City indie hip hop scene. Some of my buddies, So Soon, Ms. P, Cooley High, and they're all in my new documentary as well. But thank you. And Jorge, what are some of your career highlights? Some of the names you may have faced, some of the big events you may have been on.
My career highlights. I remember I was like 2 years into the game, I was trained by Johnny Rods, and
really?
It was me, Johnny Rods versus Honky Tonk Man and some guy named Flex.
Okay.
Yeah, it was cool. Like, it was like the first time, so I'm like, yes, I'm a legend, this and that. I also wrestled out in Arizona in 2010. That's a big highlight. And big name also, Carlito was there, Tommy Dreamer, Charlie Haas. You know, Dennis Rodman was there as a host. It was good. It was fun. It was definitely, we got to travel all together. So it's one of those things where you got to itch, like, man, I hope I don't come home. I hope I get to travel more, you know, like stuff like that.
Yeah, like the old territory days.
Yeah. The old territory days. It's true. Hopefully my future aspirations, I get somewhere signed or, you know, I just want to give people good wrestling.
There you go. So, as an indie wrestler, what do you see as the path to the so-called big time? How do you make that transition, like a CM Punk or a Bryan Danielson or a Austin Aries?
Yeah, transition. Just, I guess, publicize yourself a lot. If you're on the indies, just keep. You know, if you know anybody that can make T-shirts, make yourself a T-shirt. You know, have people wear your stuff. You know. Always, now we're in a big Facebook world, so Facebook yourself, let people know you exist, you know, show, you know, you can post up your matches, you can post up promos, you know, and just keep pushing yourself to the next level, you know, that's the only way, you know, I was told always wait for something to happen, but, you know, you don't make your opportunities, you make your opportunities happen, you don't wait for them to happen, you know, and just keep pushing yourself, you know, sometimes I get shy when it comes around with the bigger names and stuff around me because of the fact that I don't want to be that guy at all. Here he is trying to talk to me, try to get somewhere and stuff. But in reality, I just like make good friends and, you know, and see what's out there. I know Ring of Honor, TNA, WWE, those are the main places you want to go in America. If you're in Japan, you want New Japan, all those places, and, Mexico. But, like, right now, maybe I want to start off In the footsteps of CM Punk, maybe I want to start off, you know, with Austin Aries, go to Ring of Honor, see if they like me there, you know. And I'm pretty sure that, you know, I could face to face all that talent over there because they're really good, very athletic, it's very competent. So
I'll give you a little tip from a WWE Hall of Famer, Johnny Valiant. He said,
sure,
as you walk to the ring, within 30 seconds, the audience should understand your character. You're the good guy cowboy. You're the bad guy cowboy. You're the good guy Indian. You're the bad guy Indian. Whatever. It can't be too complicated. It can't be too complicated. So, the wrestling fans, you know, for the most part, are not like deep thinkers. You know, they just want to be entertained.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
I've had indie wrestlers go into the elaborate conversations on who their character is. I'm a tweener because da-da-da-da-da-da. No, too complicated. Keep it simple.
Yeah.
You know?
Backstory for that. Just write a book.
Exactly. Anyway, we must wrap it up. So please, if you have any websites, Facebook pages, plug anything you want to plug the next minute.
All right, I got you. You guys looking for me, you like me. Facebook, you just type in Torsanti, you'll see me right away. Along with YouTube, you want to see some YouTube matches with myself and stuff, just type in Jorge Santi versus, and you'll see a bunch of matches I have up online. Also, I believe the URL is FirebirdSanti1. And that's basically it. I'm a just Facebook, YouTube type of guy, because I feel like those work. for some reason, I never got into Twitter yet, but I will someday.
There you go. And that's JORGESANTI. There you go.
Versus, yeah, exactly.
Okay, and we want to thank AJ Pan for setting this up, and best of luck to... Oh, absolutely, and best of luck to you and FWE and AJ, and it's a nice crew. I've met all of them, and, you know, some indies, the promoters, you wouldn't spit on them if they were on fire, but the FWE guys, they're a good crew. I like them. I wish them nothing
but
the best.
They're very loyal, and they want to make sure this runs for a long, long time, and that's a good thing, because there's not much any guys that want to. And not any guys. There's not much promoter that, you know, really look out for their company. They just look out for themselves sometimes.
And if you keep mixing name talent and beautiful lady wrestlers and top indie guys who can actually work, as opposed to your cousin, your next door neighbor, somebody you owe a favor to, you know, these guys have the right formula. They really do have the right formula. So
it's very smart how they put their stuff together.
Wish you guys all the best, and thank you for appearing last second on Legends Radio. A pleasure to have on. Thank you, Jorge.
Thank you.
And you got it. And this is Evan Ginsberg for Dr. Mike, for Rick Hendrickson. We will be back in our regular time slot next Wednesday night at 7 p.m. And what can I say? Julie Newmar, Nona Hendrix, and pro wrestling. It's quite a mix.
It doesn't get better than that.
That's right. Thank you, Rick. Thank you, Dr. Mike.